I was born in New York City, but we moved out to Larchmont, New York, where I grew up.
And so did you kind of grow up your early years during the Depression?
I was right in the middle of it.
And did the Depression affect your family?
Overall, yes. I bet it didn't affect the way I lived, I don't think. But my father and my uncle, who had been tremendous successes, they came from Russia in 1899. And just before the Depression, I think they owned 22 buildings in New York City. And they lost every one of them.
Tell me about your early childhood. What is an example of, what did you do for fun in the summers in that era, that kind of thing?
I lived on my bicycle, I think.
Was it a more safe and secure kind of childhood?
I mean, yes, very much so.
Were you the kind of kid who liked school?
Yes, I was very industrious.
When you walk into a classroom, you have this full spectrum of personalities. You know, these little kids are the smart kid, the quiet kid, the class clown, if we walked into your classroom, which kid were you?
I was probably the studious one.
So you liked school and that you kind of took to it?
Yeah, I kind of went by the ruling that if you know the answer, it's easy. And if you don't have the answer, you find what it is, and then it's easy.
Did you come from a larger family or that?
Just my brother and myself.
What kind of work did your dad do once you'd moved to Larchmont?
He came over to the United States from Russia in 1899 and didn't speak a word of English. And by the time he was 30, he was a millionaire. He and my uncle started a dress manufacturing company, which I understand became the largest in the United States. They sold it out in 1917, before he met my mother.
What values did he pass on to you? What do you see in yourself that came from your father?
I think I got a good mind and everything. Unfortunately, he died when I was 16 years old. He came down with Parkinson's before they knew what Parkinson's was in 1936. And it was very dreadful. He was a very strong, athletic man, had boats and horses and everything else. And the last 2 years, he couldn't walk, so we had to carry him. The last year, he couldn't talk. And for somebody like that, it must have been awfully hard.
And in that era, too.
Yeah.
When you look back on your childhood, who do you think had probably the biggest influence on you?
I don't know. My mother had a very large family, and I had a very favorite uncle. And I don't know how to say it. He was busy in everything, and he was always there when I needed him.
When you look back on your childhood, and even though the devastating impact of the Depression, the loss of a father in your teenage years, I mean, did you like your childhood?
Yes, I grew up in a really great place. Larchmont was just marvelous. It was halfway between New York City and Connecticut on the Long Island Sound. So we spent a lot of time on the Long Island Sound, swimming and everything else. I was just starting my freshman year at MIT, and we came down that morning and we were listening to the radio before we even got dressed and couldn't believe it happened. Just incredulous.
Did you have some sense that foreboding you were going to be called up?
They had formed something at the colleges called the ERC, the Enlisted Reserve Corps, and it was supposed to keep you in college until you graduated, then you go into the armed services. But I just didn't particularly like that, so I volunteered for the Air Force, and they called me in April of 43, right, in the middle of my fourth term, which I got no credit for when I came back.
Why did you choose the Army Air Corps?
I honestly don't know. I never expected to be a success as a pilot. And I think I was in basic training when I made my first solo. And I said, you know, I like this, and I'm going to finish.
And that's it's an interesting point. Had you been in an airplane before you went into the service?
No.
See, that's the irony, is joining the Army Air Corps, but you'd never been in an airplane, that kind of thing, and became a pilot. Take me through sort of the story of joining up and how they really took a kid from Largemont, or a college kid, and turned him into a pilot. I mean, take me through that.
Well, I was called in 1943, and we had to just wear a nice suit, and it met us in a train in New York going to Mississippi. And we were right next to a beautiful train, but we didn't use that one. We used an old train that had wires going from car to car with one lamp in the middle of the car. And we were on that thing for 3 days and three nights. I remember going through West Virginia, and they said it was such a small country, but we were there all night long. Every time we stopped in a station, we'd open the window. Where are we? We're in West Virginia. And we went down to Keesler Field, Mississippi.
Is that the first time you'd been in the South and such a different environment?
First time, yeah.
Well, take me through then the training and that kind of thing.
I think the training was absolutely excellent. We had pre-flight there at Keesler, and I remember I had some background in ROTC, so they made me the head of the platoon. And we were marching in that bright sun in 6 inches of sand. And one day we went in to get our typhoid shots, and gradually, one at a time, everybody collapsed. I think that night for supper, out of 220 men, only about 11 showed up for supper.
And so you started this rather rigorous training down there.
Very.
Take me through then sort of how the flight training started.
Well,
what
the
kind of
first thing we went to, they wanted everybody to have some college training. And I already had a year and a half at MIT, and they sent us to what they call a CTD, College Training Detachment. And they sent me to Winthrop College for 5 months or 6 months. Winthrop College was South Carolina's college for women.
Oh.
And there were 400 students, 400 cadets and 1,500 girls, and it's been the only place I ever was where the girls cut in on the dance floor. And we got 10 hours in a Piper Cub, and I was really not looking forward to flying after that, because I think in the 10 hours I threw up twice.
Just the air sick kind of thing?
Yeah, right. And then we went from there to Birmingham for a pre-flight, which was very rigorous in the summer. It was very hot.
And were you flying other kinds of aircraft?
No, we weren't flying at all. We went to pre-flight, and pre-flight was just learning basic things about the Air Force and flying and everything without flying. And then we went to primary flying, which was at Clarksdale, Mississippi, where we started with open cockpit planes. We flew a PT-23, which is a nice little airplane.
Was that the Stearman?
No, the Stearman. This was a lower wing monoplane. Mm. And I always laugh about seat belts, because the instructor took me up, and it's an open cockpit. You know, you look up, and there's this guy. And he asked me, is your belt tight? And I said, oh, yeah, it's tight. And he said, whoop, we went upside down. And it wasn't tight. It was loose. And there I'm hanging there looking up at the ground. I couldn't wait till he straightens out. And after that, forever, I always had a tight seat belt. It was a great lesson.
And so you're sort of moving up from the Piper Cub to this aircraft.
Yeah,
take me through the progression then.
Well, we spent about 3 months getting, I think, about 75 hours at each place, who were primary, basic, and advanced. And the PT-23 was a great little airplane, and I learned to really enjoy it very much. We used to practice doing spins, you know, left spin and right spin. It's a very versatile airplane. And I remember one day I was up there doing spins, and I cleared myself with a 90-degree bank to the right, nobody left there, and then the left, and nobody there, and I just went into a spin. And you can count the turns, one half, turn, one turn, one and a half. In the middle of that second, I look up, and right under me is a hell diver, a Navy hell diver, completely camouflaged. You couldn't see it against the trees. And I was so startled that I took my hands off the controls, and it came out of the spin by itself. And I decided the plane flew better than we could fly it. But it was a very interesting time. And then we went to basic from there down to Greenville, Mississippi, where we flew basic trainer BT-13s. It was called the Vulti Vibrator. And the reason it got that name was when you went into a spin, the first half of turn was very smooth, then the second half was plane would shake, then the third half would be smooth again, and the fourth. It was one of those crazy things, an idiosyncrasy about the airplane. And I got my time in that, and I really started enjoying flying then.
And so where did it go from there?
I was too big to go to fighters. I was too tall.
How tall were you?
6 foot one and a half. So they sent me to a multi-engine plane in Illinois. I can't think of the name of the street. The airfield that doesn't exist anymore. It's been turned to a housing development. But I flew AT-10s. AT-10 was a twin-engine Beechcraft.
Did you notice a real difference moving from the single engine to the multi-engine?
Not really. This particular trainer that they had had very small wings, and it was very, very hard to land and take off of this thing. To see, even the instructors you go out, they were having trouble landing them. And so it was good training. And then I went for 1 month after I graduated, I was sent down to Panama City, where they had an air base there that trained gunners. And we'd go up, we'd take these gunners up, and they would shoot at moving targets or at the water. And it was very interesting. I tried a 50 caliber machine gun, a waist gun, and you try to make an X on the water. And it's very, very hard because you make the X. By the time you come back to make the other cross, you've gone a couple of hundred feet. You know, you're moving along. So it was quite an education. And when I got there, it was very interesting because one of the pilots there had graduated high school a year ahead of me, Larry Schofield. And I wasn't very friendly with him in high school, but we got very friendly there. And I got assigned as co-pilot for the whole time I was there. And he was married, so I used to have dinner with him occasionally, really nice couple. And then after 1 month, I don't know why, but they sent us down, sent me down to Keesler Field in Florida. And that was for first pilot training. And I did that for 3 months and learned how to fly a B-17.
What was your impression? Do you remember what your impression was of the B-17?
It was a big airplane for me. I was small. I mean, I was skinny. You won't believe this, but I was 147 pounds when I was in the Air Force. And I could slip into that airplane quite easily. I've been trying it lately. I have trouble now. And I'm not that fat, but the plane that used to look so large is now looking small.
How did it, if you can, how did the B-17 fly, say, compared to other airplanes?
I was lucky in a lot of ways because I had gone through an engineering school for the B-17 as a co-pilot for 1 month at Panama City. And then I went to another engineering school with when you're taking your training. And when we got into overseas training, when we got our crews together, and we flew 6 hours every other day at different hours around Florida. And I went to a third engineering school. I knew that airplane backwards and forwards. And if my controls got shot off, I could still land that airplane. I mean, I really knew that airplane very well.
Talk about the phase training when the crew came together and what that was like. You had all these strangers coming together.
Well, we got through in Plant Park in Florida, Tampa, and the day we got through, we started a scheduled flying immediately, 6 hours, and it was a night flight, took off at 8 o'clock. And so they picked me because I'd been flying all over Florida. I wasn't going to get lost. And the first thing that we do, we took off as a crew. We flew across to the East Coast, where Disneyland now is. I can't think of the name of the town.
Anaheim?
Orlando.
Oh.
And we saw an open air movie, so we started circling the movie. Probably drew the people, drove them crazy on the ground, but we were watching the movie. And in the middle of this thing, because we had to fly 6 hours, I was going to take my crew on a tour all over Florida. My number two engine went out. The oil pressure dropped, so I had to feather the engine, and we had to fly back 100 miles back to our base and make a night landing with one, three engines. And my crew had never flown with me. And it turned out my navigator and bombardier, my bombardier is here at the, now, he's we lost our navigator last year. They had to get off out of the nose because you can't land with anybody in the nose in case you nose over. In the landing, and they got between me and the co-pilot, and we made, I think it was probably the best landing I've ever made. You couldn't even feel you were on the ground. And after that, I had total confidence, my crew had total confidence in me. They decided that if we're going to have, we're going to go down, they would rather crash land with me than jump.
And so you went through the crew phase training.
OTU is called, Overseas Training Unit, and we trained with pilots who had been in combat.
Was that helpful?
Oh, gosh, yeah.
What kinds of things would they be telling you?
One of the silliest things, I said, it was 20 below zero, and when you're flying in Florida, it's so hot, you're wearing a T-shirt. You touch the airplane, you can get burned, you know. There's nothing as hot as a B-17 in hot weather, and as cold as a B-17 in cold weather. I'll tell you about that later. But we were wearing a T-shirt, so when you get up to 20,000 feet, it's 20 below, and you have to start putting clothes on. And I asked the combat pilot, I said, how do you stay warm in combat? Because it's much colder than 20 below. When we flew over England, it was 60 below. And he says, I don't know. He says, you just look out there and you see the flak and you see the German fighters. It kind of warms you up. January 1st, 1945, we were scheduled to fly our 6-hour flight at 3 o'clock in the morning, January 1st. And since it was New Year's Eve, nobody went to sleep, but I didn't drink a drop because you don't. That was one thing good about military pilots that they don't get when they're training them in the flying in the airlines is you do not drink 24 hours before you fly, not a drop. And so I didn't, but I got back to the base about 2 o'clock and feeling a little bit tired. And I had never had a cup of coffee in my life. So I went to the mess hall, the officer's mess, and they had a big pitcher, a big container there. I drank 3 mugs of coffee, first time. And I don't know if it had any effect or not, but by the time I got to the flight line at 2 o'clock, my crew was there, and my engineer was unconscious. He'd been drinking too much. And the major came around and said, any crew that's not in the air at 3 o'clock is scheduled. The whole crew gets court-martialed. So my crew picked up Bert Stevens, my engineer, and took him out to the airplane and gave him pure oxygen with a mask for 15 minutes. And after 15 minutes, he was up doing his work. He wasn't happy, but he was doing his job. Alcohol is very good. Oxygen is good for alcohol. And I just point that out. But we flew from there to Hunter Field, Savannah, Georgia, where we picked up a brand new B-17 with 37 hours on it. It was so new, we had to calibrate all the instruments and everything, which took about 4 days. And then we took off. And I knew we were going to leave around noon. That's what was scheduled to go for your point of embarkation, which I think was up in Maine. And after we took off, we stopped at every place where my crew lived and buzzed their hometown. And my brother was in the V-12 program, in the Navy flying program at Duke University. And I told him, I don't know what day it's going to be, but if you see a B-17 doing figure eights over the chapel at Duke University, that's me. And he says, I practically started a riot. He told everybody. And they're all there, came out to see us go overseas. And it was interesting because the plane was brand new. And without much of a load, it could, when we took off, it could climb 1,500 feet a minute, which was incredible for a four-engine bomber. And we started on our path going overseas and got over the Statue of Liberty, The first time I lived in New York, but I never saw the Statue of Liberty until I got over in the air. And in the middle of going over the Statue of Liberty, again, my number two engine oil pressure dropped. And I said, gee, there's a brand new engine. I don't want to fool it, mess it up. So I feathered it, and we landed, made an emergency landing at Fort Dix. Well, the problem was the engines were so new that they were idling so slowly that they weren't working the pressure, the pump. That's why my oil pressure. All I do is just raise the RPM a little bit and it would have made it. So they changed our port of embarkation to Grenier Field, Manchester, New Hampshire. And we made the landing there. And as I said, I had a lot of faith in the B-17. It just flew beautifully. But one thing we didn't have was a temperature gauge in the carburetor. And in cold weather, and this is January, freezing weather, if you pull too fast on your engines, your carburetor freezes up and you're a dead duck in the air. And I made a normal landing at Grenier Field, and I just looked out at the eyes. Your eyes are always moving. And I see trees on both sides. It was a very steep descent. And after I got on the ground, first question I asked, have you had any trouble with carburetor ice? And they say, yeah, we had two B-17s glide in last month, and B-24 crashed. B-24 is when you lose their money, their engines, they have no lift at all. And it was interesting.
And so where did you go from there?
We went from there to Gander, Newfoundland, which is a huge army base. The runways were 1,500 feet wide. You could almost cross land on the thing. And it was freezing up there too. And it was like landing and taking off in a canyon because the snow was 10 feet high on both sides of the runway. And we got stuck there for 10 days because it was bad weather over the Atlantic. And we had an 11-hour flight ahead of us from there to Grenier to, I can't even think of where it was in
Scotland. Was it in Iceland?
Scotland.
Did you stop in Iceland or
no,
did you go
no,
all the way?
No, nonstop flight in 11 hours. And so we got stuck there for 10 days because the weather was bad over the Atlantic. And while we were there, they lost two B-24s. And so, nine of us volunteered, flights of three, and we crisscrossed that whole island at 50 feet, looking for the crash that the B-24s never did find them. And we figured what finally happened was they crashed into a lake and it just froze over the top of them. But anyhow, we did take off at 12 o'clock midnight in the middle of January, and it was really very interesting. I was a very conscientious pilot, and one of the things they do when you're flying a B-17, you have a blindfold cockpit check. They blindfold you, and you got to touch every instrument by hand, and you got to go through procedures blindfolded. So I knew, but you still use a checklist because no matter how good you are, you can still miss something. Well, when we taxied over to land to take off, I locked the brakes, thank God, and ran my engines up. And I couldn't get more than 19 inches on the manifold pressure. And you need 46 to take off. And I said, what the heck? We had not turned on our generators. Four generators we had missed on the checkout. So we just flipped the switch on, and that was all there was to it. But if I hadn't locked the brakes, I couldn't have stopped that airplane because the batteries were dead. And I would have flown, I would have taxied right into a snowbank and ruined four engines. So it's very important to make to follow your checklist. And we were very conscientious about it. And then we took off, and about 4 hours out, my co-pilot decided to go back and have a cigarette. And my ball turret gunner, who was in flight training but had washed out, always liked to fly, so he's sitting in the cockpit, in the co-pilot's cockpit, and he taps him on the shoulder, points to the air and to the airspeed. My airspeed is dropping a little bit. So I raised the controls up the RPM and the manifold pressure, and I kept on raising and it kept on dropping. And pretty soon I was doing 46 inches takeoff, and I couldn't put the nose down anymore. It was climbing on me. And I said, this is ridiculous. My airspeed's gone. What had happened was the pitot tube had a heater out in the wing, and the heater had failed, and therefore I wasn't getting any reading to my airspeed. So we just leveled off, and with the preset conditions we had, 1900 RPM, I guess it was, and the whatever manifold pressure we had, and flew for another 7 hours right out in the airspeed indicator. And my crew was kind of acceptable. They thought I might have to ditch. And the North Atlantic in January is very unfriendly. And two planes in our group did have to ditch. and they found them in their life rafts, but they were frozen solid. I mean, it was just nasty, you know.
And that's a good point. Did you go over alone, or were you in a group?
No, we went flew alone. And my navigator was just a peach of a guy. He'd gone to Virginia Polytech. You know where they had the shooting recently? Well, I was sold on that school because he was so damned. He had graduated. He was a little older than I am. And you couldn't get a better navigator. I mean, if he was lost, everybody was lost. And we never got lost, except one time, which I can tell you about later. But he had to navigate us across the ocean without any airspeed indicator for another 7 hours. And we landed, and as soon as we got down near the ground, the airspeed started kicking because it warmed up. But we had 2,800 gallons of gasoline when we took off. And when we landed, 11 hours later, we still had 1,400 left. We could have flown another 11 hours. Incredible airplane.
Did you get to keep the B-17?
Oh, no, no. I had to sign it over. What was really interesting, and it just amused me from that point on, they transfer the ownership of the B-17 to the pilot, and then he's got to take that over and deliver it to another administration. And I had a copy of the invoice, one B-17, $330,000, and one pair of binoculars, $900. I always was so amused at that. And we didn't have copy machines in those days, and I didn't have a camera. I was dying to get a copy of that instrument, but I had to turn it in with the B-17 when we landed. And then we took a train down to London, and then we got sent out to Framlingham. The base was a typical farm base. They had planted 135 air bases in an area of East Anglia the size of Delaware. And every 10 miles there was an air base. They said that if you were in trouble at night when you're flying, you just say, Mayday, 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 and they light up a field under you. But it was densely populated by airplane, by the 8th Air Force.
Did the training continue even once you got over there? What were they showing you?
Well, first of all, we had to get checked out for combat. And we had to go through bombing runs with 100-pound bomb practice bombs and everything else.
Did they emphasize the importance of close formation flying?
Yeah, oh, that's why I'm here.
Tell us about that.
Our colonel, he was the reason he saved our lives. He was a strict, strict man.
Which colonel is this?
That's Joe Mueller. Who died a number of years ago, and my wife just died this last year. And before he took over the control of the 390th Bomb Group, he insisted on flying 35 missions as a tail gunner so he could study formation. And when he took over the group, he made you fly very tight. You had to have wingtip clearance, because if you get hit, the plane just stops dead. I remember one mission I was flying along, and all of a sudden, I was flying left wing in the slot. Are you familiar with that? And one of my roommates in my barracks was flying the right plane. And all of a sudden, he's going backwards, you know? And what the heck happened? And he gets on the air, and he says, I've just lost three engines, and my instrument panel exploded. I'm going down. And they crash-landed on. We were just going over the German lines. And what had happened, the ship above him was loading the machine guns, and they accidentally went off. You know, you talk about friendly fire. And they crash-landed on the German lines, ran across the line, and they were back in the barracks 3 days later. That's the way it was at the end of the war, you know.
So Colonel Mahler really emphasized close formation flying. What was the benefit of that?
The benefit was that if you were, you know, we were pretty good. We really were good. Used to stick my wing in the window, waist window of the airplane, no big deal. But you had to keep wingtip clearance, and that was all. If you were tight like that, any enemy fighter that came in was facing 50 machine guns. Very tight operation. And so we had absolutely tight formation. We flew along with the 100th Bomb Group. They're famous for
the Bloody 100th.
The Bloody 100th, also called the Vanishing Americans. They left planes left and right. And we were flying along. They're just 1 minute away, which is about 2.5-3 miles. And we could see them get attacked, and we weren't getting attacked because of our tight formation. And after the war, well, I think it was a couple of years ago, my navigator was telling me, he said, I never told you this before, he said, but the only reason we got through the war is because of you. And I said, you mean I learned how to dodge the flak? And he said, no, he said, we had good discipline on our crew. And after the war ended, why he got reassigned to another crew, he said, we never would have made it with that pilot. He didn't have any discipline. But we had a great, very good, good crew.
How many missions did you fly?
I flew 18.
And you're obviously not going to remember all 18 missions, but are there missions for one reason or another that stand out in your memory?
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about some of those
the
missions.
The one mission, we bombed Nuremberg that day. And they really must have wanted it bombed, because at the briefing, they always show you a cross-section of the weather. It was solid black. And we laughed, we're not going to fly today. But we got suited up and everything. And incidentally, getting suited up was a half an hour procedure. It was 60 below zero up there. And you had to, didn't have much, just no heating on the plane at all. So we had about six layers of clothing we had to put on. And by the time we got dressed, it took a half an hour. And if they scrub the mission, we actually get upset after going through all that trouble. But when they told us to take off, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't see the runway where I was. And it was the first time I'd ever made an instrument takeoff. I was on the runway. I couldn't see the runway more than about 50 or 100 feet ahead. It was really dense. And my co-pilot put his head against the window, and he could see a little bit of discoloration between the runway and the ground next to it. And we set our gyros on, you know, in the higher heading we were going to follow, and started down the runway. And if he felt I was getting a little too close or too far, he'd nudge me, and I'd make a half a degree correction on the instrument. And it's very unusual. Let's put it that way.
How far apart are the airplanes as they're taking off?
Well, that was one of the marvelous things, and it shows in the movie. The lead plane, everybody in the 8th Air Force had a hack watch. And at the briefing, everybody at the 8th Air Force goes through a setting where you have 10, 9, 8 down to 1 hack. Everybody's watch was set exactly at the same time in the whole 8th Air Force. And it had to be that way because the groups, we had a lot of groups. We put up 1,500 bombers every day, and about 36 in each group. And each group had to take off and get to a certain point on the English Channel 1 minute apart. So you had one group followed by another group, and it took over an hour for the 8th Air Force to cover any one point. I mean, it's a lot of airplanes. And you had to start your engines exactly at the right point, and you started taxiing at the right point, and your 9 planes going up to the runway. The first plane would taxi down on the runway, and as soon as he started taking off, the second plane would be there, and 30 seconds later, he was moving, and the next one. In 4 minutes, we had the whole squadron of 9 planes flying. And on that particular day to Nuremberg, we'd get into formation. You'd climb up through the clouds, always clouds in England, and you'd climb up through the clouds and get on the top of them, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 feet, and there's this bright globe of orange up there, and you look over the back of the top of the clouds, it's like the back of a sheep as far as you can see. And it would take 15 minutes to get into formation, and the whole group would form very quickly, and you'd be on your route. I forgot I was going to say something about the takeoff, but anyhow, that day for Nuremberg, it was so bad, the weather was so bad that we couldn't form over England like we always did. So we just climbed over the point of embarkation over the English Channel and kept on climbing up to 12,000 feet where we joined over Lyon, France. And it took, at that altitude, 12,000 feet, the plane is not flying this, it's like flying like that because the air is so thin. And it took us where it usually takes 15 minutes for the form to get into formation. It took us about 45 minutes. And then from then on, everything seemed to get worse. I mean, we saw, you could see just clouds all around us. He had no reference to the ground at all. We were on instruments, complete instruments. And when you're on instruments, you have to read the instruments, and then you're flying next to the plane, and you feel like you're sliding into it, and you look at the instruments, and you're not. So you get vertigo, like mad, nauseous. My co-pilot and I were passing the stick back for every 5 minutes. I mean, we were just getting very nauseous. And finally, we got on the initial point, the IP, where you turn, the group turns on the target. And on the final approach at 30,000 feet, all of a sudden we're down to 27. They found out that the lead ship's altimeter wasn't working, so we had to reform around the secondary ship to make the bomb road run. And after bombs away, we always went into a vertical bank and turned 90 degrees and lost 1,000 feet because the German flak was very accurate, straight and level. And when you turn on that IP, you probably have a couple of puffs of flak on your wing. By the time you got to the target 10 minutes later, you used to joke that it was so solid you could get out and walk on it. It was an explosion, just solid gray. And to get away from that, you made a sudden turn. And one of the things that would happen sometimes, you had two squadrons turning and they'd kind of mesh. We used to call it shuffling the deck. And I've never been concerned about heavy traffic on the ground ever since. And then we turned back, and I've never seen weather like that. It was just absolutely black out there. So Colonel Moeller, we were leading the 8th Air Force that day, so he instructed all of the tail gunners to have the portable landing light that we carried, a very bright light, just like a landing light on the plane, to pass it back to the tail gunner so he could blink it. And I am flying in the left lower slot, and I'm 8 feet below the tail gun. And I couldn't see the light blinking. I mean, it was so dense.
You've got to be thinking, how are we going to land?
Well, what I just said, bye, literally. And we drifted off like that and broke out at 11,000 feet, B-17s all over the sky, same way, you know, they broke out of infantry, getting into formation again. And one of the only bad things that happened was that they had done some experimentation which we didn't know about. And they had painted these planes red and yellow. And they had taken off some of the turrets to see if they could get 10 miles an hour more out of them. And we didn't know about that. And the Germans had a full group of planes that they had reconstructed from crashed B-17s. We shot down a lot of our own planes. We didn't know who they were. And then we hit at 8,000 feet, we hit it again. And broke up and broke out over the ground. Didn't know where the hell we were. Somewhere in Europe. Hedge hopping into the clouds and the trees, and we were flying so low, the Germans had flak towers where they had anti-aircraft guns way up mounted. We were flying below them. They couldn't shoot us. And we didn't know where we were. Even Joe was lost, and he was lost, everybody was lost. And then all of a sudden I saw a big city underneath me, and I had to climb, and it was in front of me. I had to climb up to make it underneath me. Had to climb up about 100 feet, and we look down, and there is a picture postcard of Brussels right under us. And the people are waving, you know, because we're so low. We're just going over the roofs of the buildings. And we knew where we were, so Joe set a course, and we flew across the English Channel at 30 feet above the waves, because we had no protection in case a German fighter came. And we got to the cliffs of Dover, had to climb to get over them. And we were home.
And was it 30 feet above the waves because you'd stay below German radar? Is that the idea?
Yeah, we were below everything. You know, and fighters, we had no protection. A single plane was no measure for a fighter. Talking about fighters, I think it was November or December of 1944 that they made a simple development that changed the war. The P-51s used to escort us to the target. When they got to the target, their fuel tanks were empty. And when the German attacked, they had to turn and run. They put on some plywood, quarter-inch plywood, disposable tanks under the wings of the Mustangs. And when they got to the target, they dropped those, and they had a full gas tank. The first time the Germans attacked, they were in for a surprise, because the 51 was superior to the ME-109, the Focke-Wulf 190, everything they flew, except for the ME-262.
The jet.
Yeah, and we were, you know, most people didn't realize that there were jets then, because our armed forces didn't have any jets.
Did you ever see any jets?
Yeah, we got attacked one day by
Tell us about that.
And that, you know, it's interesting. It happened on April 7th. I remember the date quite clearly. Because this is about as close as I've gotten to being killed, I think. And we have flak all the time, but you don't think of it so much. But we were flying along, and all of a sudden my bombardier calls out flak at 12 o'clock. And I see brown explosions under the nose. And I say, that's a funny color for flak, Joe, because flak is usually black. And then the ship was shaking, I knew the guns were going off. And all of a sudden I thought it was a P-51 going right over my wing, about 20 feet away. I could see the pilot, as clear as you are right here. And then I realized, because I looked like a P-51 with wing tanks, and all of a sudden I realized, that is no P-51, he is out of sight going with me. He's doing about 450 miles an hour, and I'm doing 150. Like I'm sitting on a street corner, and it was an ME-262, and that was his 30-millimeter cannon that was exploding under our nose, and my bolt turret gunner told us that two of them had attacked us, and one went over the wing, and he said the other one went down. My tail gunner got off 50 shots, my top turret gunner got off 2 shots, my bolt turret gunner couldn't turn his turret fast enough. And then this other 51 went down, and he started slowing down because they had very little fuel. They could only fly at full speed of 15 minutes. And he started slowing down without realizing there was a P-51 on his tail, and the P-51 got him. But our standard operator for that plane, which was a magnificent airplane, they have some in the Smithsonian, they'd attack, and he immediately would pull away. But he could only do that 3 times. And after the 4th time, they were like a glider. And I've seen the fighter kills, you know, they take 35-millimeter film when you pull the trigger on a P-51, shooting 2 of them down at the same time, going in for a landing. And
that was its Achilles heel. It was after that third turn, it was a glider.
It was gone, yeah. Uh-huh. And what was interesting was that the... I'm trying to think back. He missed me, but that was his 30-millimeter cannon going off, but he got the plane above me. Mm-hmm. One of my guys in my barracks named Cotta. And it was interesting because he had been flying with 4 bad engines, so overnight they gave him 4 brand-new engines. And he was flying with 4 brand-new engines, and they gave him advertising to drop, you know, instead of bombs.
Oh, propaganda.
Yeah, to make it lighter. And he was flying above me, and he was flying out of formation. And that's how they came down and picked him off. But that was near the end of the war. And they all bailed out. The plane caught fire, and they all bailed out. We call it a count of the chutes. They were made PWs. It was over, I think we were bombing Holland at that time. And then a week later, Montgomery moved forward, and they were back in our barracks 2 weeks later. I mean, it was a crazy war at the end.
You've talked about 2 pretty memorable missions, the Nuremberg mission, this mission with the German jets. Were there other missions that stood out in your mind for one reason or another?
No, we got hit by flak every time.
Talk about flak. You know, for people who don't really know what flak is, what is it? How does it affect the airplane?
The Germans were really bright. They designed an 88-millimeter cannon that they use on the tanks, on the ground, for everything, also for anti-aircraft. And these were 88-millimeter shells that were flying, that were exploding. And the explosion, the small pieces, if it gets you in the wrong place, the plane is gone. We always had holes, and I'll swear the stuff exploded vertically, because all the holes we had were vertical, not horizontal. But on one mission when we landed, the crew chief came out, and he handed me a little piece of my airplane about that big, and a piece of German flak that was stuck in it and had wedged in the bomb bays. He says, you're going to want this as a souvenir, and I still got it. And the shrapnel, it was a piece of steel, and it started rusting, and I had to put some nail polish on it, so it's not the original color. But I still have that piece of my plane. My plane was called Cocaine Bill, which raises a lot of eyebrows today. The sister ship that got shot down was Morphine Sue. And in those days, drugs had a different meaning altogether. Standard equipment on every parachute was a tube with a needle of morphine. Because if somebody got hit up there, you're hours away from a doctor All he can do is tie a tourniquet and give him a shot of morphine. So it was standard equipment.
Was anybody on your crew ever injured?
We were very, very lucky. Extremely lucky. We lost our first engine. We lost our first mission. We lost an engine. But everything else didn't hit anything vital. I had holes in the wing I could climb through. But we were very, very lucky. It's all luck.
What was your feeling about that? Because it almost seemed like being in the right place or at the right time, the wrong place at the wrong time. Some planes would go down, some wouldn't. You know, how do you handle that? You carry a lucky rabbit's foot? What was your perspective?
I forgot I've had a rabbit's foot or not. I'll tell you about rabbits afterwards. But we had two things. Everybody was so dedicated. I mean, it was a different world than we're living in today. The closest we came to it was 9/11, but it didn't last. But everybody in the United States, everybody, and that was our job. You had two choices. When you took off, you're either going to go over the target and drop your bombs, or you're going to get shot down. Those were two choices, and nothing else mattered. And we never knew if we were going to be alive again the next day, which is a rather interesting thing, because everybody in England, it was the same way. They had V-2s and V-1s landing all the time, and people getting killed all the time because you never knew where they're going to fall. And it changed. It was a crazy thing because it changed your values altogether. The British girls used to say that the American soldiers were overpaid, oversexed, overfed, and overhere. And, I mean, if you saw a woman, you just went to bed. It was no big deal because you didn't know if you're going to be alive the next day or not. It was a whole complete different way of thinking.
Did you get leave? Did you go into London, that kind of thing?
If you were on combat duty like we were, you got to London every other weekend. It was just a two-day trip. It was a very quick trip. It was 15 minutes from Framlingham. We used to call it the Framlingham Flyer. I think it got up to 15 miles an hour sometimes. Three stops to Ipswich, and then 1 hour to London.
In the train?
Pardon?
From Ipswich, did you take a train to London?
Train, yeah.
Was it obvious at that point that London was still a war zone? Go into London?
We B-17 can carry four 2,000-pound bombs, which is a blockbuster. It's about the same size as a V-2. And the V-2s would take off, they go up 75 miles and they come down. I don't think the total flying was less than a minute. And you didn't know where they were coming down. And I got to London one day after one hit, right at the Marble Arch. You might be familiar with that. It's where the two streets for the Green Park come in together. And it had missed the construction there, but it had made a huge hole. I mean, this was a huge hole. And every window for 10 blocks in every direction was broken. I mean, but nobody got hurt. It was just amazing. But it was amazing how the destruction went on in London. I forget the name of the church there. It's the third world biggest cathedral in the world.
Westminster Abbey?
Or? No, Park. I can't think of the name. But anyhow, it was funny. St. Paul. Every building going up the street to St. Paul was demolished. The church wasn't hit. It was a miracle.
When you flew your last mission, did you know it was going to be your last mission when you flew it?
The last three missions I flew were interesting. We bombed from 15,000 feet, which is very low. But there was an island off of the coast of France that the Germans had completely fortified, and they would not surrender. So we spent 3 days. The first day we dropped 1,000-pound bombs. The second day we dropped 2,000-pound bombs on the holes we made the day before. And the third day, which was one of the worst missions I remember, we dropped the fluid that caught fire.
Napalm?
Napalm. And we were carrying it in the wing tanks from the P-51s, quarter-inch plywood, and they were leaking like mad, and the whole plane was full of fumes. We opened every damned opening we could do then. And you couldn't drop these things all at one time if you got in trouble, because they had no fins on them. And if they hit each other, they'd splash all over the airplane. So you had to drop one at a time. And I remember that being one of very, very difficult mission because of that. It was so hazardous.
What was your situation, or where were you when Victory in Europe Day, I mean, when the war in Europe was over?
Well, VE Day, before VE Day, the Germans had taken every bit of food out of Holland. And they were eating shoes and tulip bulbs. And they were starving. And so I volunteered and flew two of the four missions. I went to Rotterdam and the capital, I can't think of it, Amsterdam. And dropped food from 50 feet, dropped sea rations. And those people never, ever forgot that.
And you were that low? Could you see people on the ground?
Oh, yeah, 50 feet off the ground. I think it was supposed to be 100, but we put it down a little lower, and because it's always fun flying near the ground. But those cartons were sea rations, and it really saved a lot of lives.
How would you know where to drop?
Oh, they had big X's marked on the fields, and the Germans had declared a truce, so they wouldn't shoot us if we stayed in a certain path. And then after the war, I volunteered. We took what we called the ground pounders, who never flew, to take a look at what we were bombing over. And we did another volunteer flight down to Czechoslovakia, to a German field where they had a lot of French PWs. They'd been prisoners of the war of the Germans. And it was very interesting. From one other point, we got down there, okay, but they were just loaded with lice. The German prisons did not have very good showers or baths, and lice was all over the place. And the way they got rid of the lice was DDT. And with the women, they just raised their skirts and spray them. And us, they just drenched us. I mean, we were just, and they did the whole plane. You couldn't touch anything without getting DDT powder. You couldn't be exposed to DDT more than we were, because it was from in the morning that day until midnight. I mean, we were just itching like that the whole time because of the powder. And DDT was so effective, it wiped out malaria in the lower United States and in Panama City. And then they stopped using it because some woman said it was destroying some birds or something. Well, they found out that was not true. But you've got 3 million people dying every year now in Africa, and they're just starting to use DDT.
Where did you fly the French prisoners?
We flew them back to Lyon, France.
It must have been very satisfying to do the Dutch food run and then to fly these Frenchmen back to their country. Was that?
Well, there was, but it taught me something. That flight for the Frenchmen, we took off at midnight, and we got back at midnight. And I say, if this is the way flying is, the hours are lousy, I'm not going to continue after the war. And I had when we got out of the Air Force, I had a multi-engine commercial pilot's license. I was 21 years old. Well, we got detached from our group, my co-pilot and I, and we flew home as passengers in a B-24. We were flown over to a base in, not in England, but I can't think of where it was, Wales. And we took off from there, we landed in Iceland, and then we landed in Labrador. It was interesting landing in Labrador, I mean in Iceland, because it was 2 o'clock in the morning and you could read in the newspaper.
It was that light out.
Yeah, and it amused me because they had, it was a collection of boulders from little ones to big ones, the whole damn country. And they, on the runways there, we saw two fields there, as far as you could see on runways, P-47s lined up. I mean, I've never seen so many P-47s, and they were all junked. And today, you know, those things are so valuable.
Was there any superstition about flying in a B-24 back across the Atlantic getting home?
No, but I'd never been in a B-24. Mm-hmm. I'd seen one in England, and I talked to a crew chief one time, and B-17s worked electrically, all the equipment on it, the autopilot and everything. The B-24s were hydraulic. And I looked at the inside the bomb bay, and it's just lined with these hydraulic lines. And I asked the crew chief, I said, have you had any trouble in combat with these things? And he says, I don't know. He says, we've never had one come back with a hole in it. Anyhow, I got behind the pilot in this B-24, which I'd never flown before, and we start down the runway, and with only 10 passengers, the plane was very, very light, and with a B-17, you're off the ground at 1,500 feet. And he puts down half flaps, and he starts down the runway, and I'm counting out 1,000 feet, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 7,000 feet, and he starts climbing about a foot or two off the ground, and he puts up his wheels and his flaps. And I was just shocked, because that's just not the way a B-17 flies. We'd be up at 10,000 feet by that time. And I asked the pilot afterwards, I said, is that a normal takeoff? He says, yeah, that's how we do it all the time.
Well, at that time in 1945, did you consider staying in the service?
No, not really.
Why didn't it appeal to you? What was your thinking?
I think a combination of those hours, and my back had gone out, and I didn't know how badly it had gone out. I think it was on my 11th mission. The way we usually got into the plane, you're so bulky with everything, to go through the waist door and up through the, you hang up on everything. So with the escape hatch in the front, we just reach up, swing up like that, take two steps, and I'm in the pilot seat. You're familiar with the airplane. On my 11th mission, I reach up and start going up, and my left leg wouldn't leave the ground. And I tried four or five times. So I went around and walked through the waist. And after that, my leg wasn't working too well. But, you know, when you're 21 years old, you're worried about what you're doing, not about yourself. And I got in the waist, and I flew my missions. And then I didn't notice anything at all until we went to Wales. And we're carrying our duffel bag and everything. And the next day, I'm walking along, and all of a sudden, I get a sharp pain in my left hip, and I'm on the ground. And I said, what the hell? I didn't know what it was. And I asked the flight surgeon. He says, you'll have to wait till you get back to the United States. So I got back and got on my 30-day leave. And I was playing tennis. And all of a sudden, the same thing happened to me. I couldn't play. So I checked in with the Army, and they put me in Mitchell Field Hospital on Long Island, which was a good hospital. And I was there for 2 weeks in bed, and they couldn't find a thing at all. And then they transferred me to another hospital in New Rochelle, closer to home. And I was there 2 weeks, and then I got out and didn't think anything of it, except every time I exercised, I had the same thing happen. So when I moved to Houston in 1950, I went to the VA hospital to get a checkup. And they found out what the problem was. My back was fusing. I had what they call ankylosing spondylitis, which about 300 million Americans have. My back started fusing. My sacroiliac was already partially fused. And I had trouble with that for many, many years. I couldn't exercise at all until, I guess it was 1961, 62, the astronauts came into Houston. And my brother was in the real estate business, and there were no apartments in Houston at that time. And he found places for all these guys to live and became very friendly with them. And he's still friendly with Scott Carpenter. He sees him every year. They go sailing together. And so I had lunch, dinner with him a few times, and I look at these guys, and here they are in just fantastic shape and doing all these things, and I couldn't do them. What was the difference? Exercise. And I started swimming. And that was the answer to my problem. And I used to swim a half a mile every day and until about 7 or 8 years ago, until every other day. And I never caught cold after that.
What kind of work did you end up doing after the war?
I graduated MIT in 48. And I had a job in New York with a manufacturing company for about 6 months, and I learned everything else I could. And then my brother had moved down to Houston, and he was working on the Shamrock Hotel, and he found a woman down there, and he was getting married, so I came down for the wedding, and I stayed. But I always started doing my own companies. I worked in the industrial laundry business for many years. And made money, and I had a family to support, and so I couldn't be too versatile. But I did send myself back to MIT in 1960-61 to the Sloan Fellowship Program, which is one of the great years of my life. And there were 44 people sent up by their companies, and I sent myself up. And they were glad to get me because I was the only MIT graduate. Everybody else could come from all the other schools. And that was one of the great years. The type of person, like myself, who was in that program, were just top people because their companies were spending a lot of money to sending them up for every year. And it's interesting, in those days, the tuition was $3,500, which they paid for. Today, the same tuition, I think, is, maybe $47,000 or something.
Do you ever think back on the old days, and back in England during the war? I mean, with your sort of wiser perspective now, what do you think about now?
Well, I'll tell you, I feel that going through the 8th Air Force in the war there was a fantastic experience if you knew you were going to be alive when you came out. But the losses of the 8th Air Force were just incredible.
Are you proud of your time in service?
Oh, yeah.
Why is that?
Because I think we knew that we had to do the job, and we did it. And the country did a magnificent job. You know, and I talk about that when I talk to these kids. We were 120 million people, and today we're 300 million. We had 11 million people in uniform, almost 10% of the population. And today the president can't even raise a million. You know, everybody was just coordinated. It was a great country. And the best thing that they ever did was the GI Bill of Rights, which paid the rest of my education and everybody else's. And the years after that, in the 50s and the 60s, was when this country changed and grew so immense because of those educated people.
You know, last question is that, you know, you were basically a college student going over there to Europe during the war years. You came back after those missions, after all that experience. How were you different when you came back from Europe?
Oh, I think that we had a lot of confidence in ourselves. We knew what we could do. We knew what we couldn't do. And at that age, to find that out is just amazing. My boys, when they're in their early 20s, were all over the place. They didn't have anything like that to do. And I could see the difference in them and me. And so it was a tremendous thing to go through, as I said, if you were going to be alive afterwards.